Hello students, I hope you are all safe, in good health and doing your assignments and reading the chapters thoroughly. Today we will discuss about the Battle of Plassey. After the death of Ali Wardi Khan in 1756, Siraj-ud-Daula became the Nawab of Bengal. He ordered the English to stop meddling in the political affairs of his dominion, to stop fortification and to pay the revenues. Earlier you had seen that the East India Company officials, they did not want to pay revenues on time. They had started making fortification around the settlements and had started meddling in the affairs of the province of Bengal. So all this was not liked by Siraj-ud-Daula, who was a very powerful Nawab. He marched with 30,000 soldiers to the English factory at Qasim Bazar, locked the warehouse, captured the company officials, disarmed them and blockaded English ships. He also established his control over company's fort in Calcutta. The company was worried about his power because the company wanted a puppet ruler who would willingly give trade concessions and other privileges. That means they wanted a ruler who would act according to the wishes of the British East India Company. But instead, Siraj-ud-Daula did not like the British officials trying to interfere in the administration of his province. So what he did was, he marched to Calcutta, took control over the company's fort, that's Fort William over there, and disarmed all the British officials. So this was not liked by the company. So Robert Clive was sent from Madras with an army reinforced by naval fleets. When negotiations with the Nawab failed, the battle took place on the banks of Hooghly River at Plassey on 23rd June 1757 between Siraj-ud-Daula, the Nawab of Bengal, and Company's army led by Robert Clive. Siraj-ud-Daula's army with 50,000 soldiers, 40 cannons and 10 war elephants was defeated by 3,000 soldiers of Colonel Robert Clive. This happened because Robert Clive had bribed Mir Zafar, who was the commander-in-chief of Nawab's army. Robert Clive also promised him to make him the Nawab of Bengal. So Mir Zafar never fought the battle, and thus Siraj-ud-Daula lost the Battle of Plassey. The battle helped the company seize control of Bengal, and it was also the first major victory of the company in India. So I would like you all to underline a few things on page number 12. Like I discussed, the company wanted a puppet ruler. Now here the meaning of puppet is given there, literally a toy that you can move with strings. The term is used disapprovingly to refer to a person who is controlled by someone else. Please underline that part over there. And there's also one thing to be underlined. Ali Wardi Khan, when did he die? And when did Siraj-ud-Daula became the Nawab of Bengal? That was the year 1756. Then please underline, Siraj-ud-Daula asked company to stop meddling in the political affairs of his dominion. Stop fortification and pay the revenues. And then when all of this failed, he marched with 30,000 soldiers to the English factory at Qasim Bazar. Underline all these things, because this is what led to the Battle of Plassey, because the Britishers felt offended. Now coming to page number 13 also, I would like you to underline. why Sirajuddaulah lost the battle, it's given. One of the main reasons for the defeat of Nawab was the forces led by Mir Zafar, one of Sirajuddaulah's commanders, never fought the battle. Clive had managed to secure his support by promising to make him Nawab after crushing Sirajuddaulah. Please underline those things. You can see picture of Sirajuddaulah over there. Now, after the defeat at Plassey, Sirajuddaulah was assassinated and Mir Zafar was made the Nawab of Bengal. The East India Company at this stage was still unwilling to take over the responsibility of administration, as its prime objective was the expansion of trade. I would like you to underline a few things there on page number 14, the very first paragraph. Sirajuddaulah was assassinated and Mir Zafar made the Nawab. So the prime objective was expansion of trade. They did not want to interfere in the or take up the responsibility of administration. But since these rulers, the ones appointed by the Britishers, did not act according to their wishes, so what they did was they had to keep on changing various Nawabs. But still again they did not act according to their wishes. Then finally what happened? The company officials, they themselves thought them to become Nawabs. So but when Mir Zafar, after becoming the Nawab of Bengal, started protesting and demanded more rights, the company installed Mir Qasim as the new Nawab of Bengal. So again now Mir Zafar, who had been promised by Robert Clive to be made as the Nawab of Bengal, he was replaced by Mir Qasim. Again, when Mir Qasim complained and tried to gain more power over Bengal, he was defeated in a battle fought at Buxar in 1764 in October by the forces of the British East India Company led by Hector Munro. So the Battle of Buxar took place in 1764. After the Battle of Buxar, Mir Zafar was reinstalled as the puppet Nawab of Bengal. Now again, Mir Qasim was removed and Mir Zafar was reinstalled. The Nawab had to pay 50,000 every month to the company. But the greed of the British East India Company increased. It wanted more revenue and more territories to meet the demands of its trade and finance. All this was needed to finance its wars and other expenses of the company officials. So Robert Clive decided that the company officials themselves become the Nawabs or the Nabobs. That's like how they spell Nabobs. I would like you to underline a few things on page number 14. Come to page paragraph number 3, the third paragraph. So there can be a question asked here, whom did the company replace as a Nawab of Bengal after Mir Zafar? So answer will be Mir Qasim. So please underline that when Mir Zafar protested, the company deposed him and installed Mir Qasim in his place. Then again, when Mir Qasim complained, he was in turn defeated in the battle of at Buxar 1764, please underline that, driven out of Bengal, and Mir Zafar was reinstalled. Then you can see it's written over there, the Nawab had to pay 500,000 every month, but the company wanted more money to finance its wars and meet the demands of trade and its other expenses. It wanted more territories and more revenue. Then there's one more line over there, which Robert Clive declared, we must, after the death of Mir Zafar in 1765, the mood of the company had changed, and then Robert Clive said, we must indeed become nawabs ourselves. Then in 1765, the Mughal emperor appointed the company as the Diwan of the provinces of Bengal. Underline that. The Diwani allowed the company to use the vast revenue resources of Bengal. So here there can be a question, how did the assumption of Diwani benefit the East India Company? So the answer will be, the Diwani of Bengal solved a major problem that the company had earlier faced. Earlier, what had happened? They had to buy most of the goods in India with gold and silver imported from Britain. This was because at this time, Britain had no goods to sell in India. So what they had to do? They had to pay in gold and silver to buy Indian products. The outflow of gold from Britain slowed after the Battle of Plassey and entirely stopped after the assumption of Diwani. Now revenues from India could finance company expenses. These revenues could be used as to purchase cotton and silk textiles in India, maintain company troops and meet the cost of building the company fort and offices at Calcutta. So this is the answer. How did the assumption of Diwani benefit the East India Company? These were the benefits that they got after they assumed the Diwani of Bengal. Now we'll discuss the topic, company officials become nawabs. What did it mean to become a nawab? It meant, of course, that the company acquired more power and authority, but it also meant something else. Each company servant began to have visions of living like nawabs. After the Battle of Plassey, the actual nawabs of Bengal were forced to give land and vast sums of money as personal gifts to company officials. Robert Clive himself amassed a fortune in India. However, not all company officials succeeded in making money like Clive. Many died an early death in India due to disease and war, and it would not be right to regard all of them as corrupt and dishonest. Many of them came from humble backgrounds, and their uppermost desire was to earn enough in India, return to Britain, and lead a comfortable life. Those who managed to return with wealth led flashy lives and flaunted their riches. They were called nawabs. An anglicized version of Indian word nawab. They were often seen as upstarts and social climbers in Britain, in British society, and were ridiculed or made fun of in plays and cartoons. Now, after the Battle of Buxar, lot of things changed. The company appointed residents in Indian states. They were political or commercial agents, and their job was to serve and further the interest of the company. I would like you to underline that on page number 15. Last paragraph, after the Battle of Buxar, the company appointed residents in Indian states. They were political or commercial agents till interest of the company. Through the residents, the company officials began interfering in the internal affairs of Indian states. They tried to decide who was to be successor to the throne and who was to be appointed in administrative posts. Sometimes the company forced the states into a subsidiary alliance. Now I would like to discuss what was the subsidiary alliance. The subsidiary alliance system was a non-intervention policy used by Governor General Lord Wellesley to establish British Empire in India. According to this system, every ruler in India had to accept to pay a subsidy to the British for the maintenance of British army. Indian rulers were not allowed to maintain their own army. They had to pay a subsidy to the British. In return, the British would protect them from their enemies and internal disorders. You can see here, according to the terms of this alliance, Indian rulers were not allowed to have their independent forces. They were to be protected by the company and had to pay for the subsidiary forces. Under Richard Wellesley as the Governor General from 1798 to 1805, the Nawab of Awadh and Hyderabad were forced to give over parts of their territory as they had failed to pay for the alliance. All the Indian rulers who entered into a subsidiary alliance would not enter into any further alliance with any other power, nor would declare war against any power without the permission of the British. If the Indian ruler failed to make the payment required by the alliance, then part of their territory was to be taken away as penalty. So I want you to underline on page number 15, third last line, subsidiary alliance. It's written over there. Indian rulers were not allowed to have their independent armed forces. They were to be protected by the company, but had to pay for the subsidiary forces that the company was supposed to maintain for the purpose of this protection. If the Indian rulers failed to make the payments, then part of their territory was taken away as penalty. For example, when Richard Wellesley was Governor General, the Nawab of Awadh was forced to give over half of his territory to the company in 1801 as he failed to pay the subsidiary forces. Hyderabad was also forced to cede territories to on similar grounds. So this is how the company started taking over the territories of various rulers. Now obviously what used to happen, the money demanded by the British for giving protection to these rulers was so high that the rulers were not able to provide on time. And when they failed to do so, a part of their territories were taken away by the British. Slowly and slowly what happened? They took over these regions and expanded their administration. So today we'll finish up here, and in the next video we'll discuss about Tipu Sultan, then war with the Marathas, doctrine of lapse, and the new administration, the company's army. I hope you'll read the chapter thoroughly and find the answers to the questions given at the back of the book, and all those dates please underline and try to remember. Children, please read the chapter and try to find the answers to these questions. You'll find all these answers in your book if you read it thoroughly. Thank you.